Greetings, Augustana Lutheran Church, members and guests, interim Pastor John greeting you this day, wherever you're watching this, however you're participating in the life and ministry of this congregation, greetings to you today, and may God's peace be with you. Just a couple of announcements. The sermon today is from Pastor Catherine Olson, a pastor that lives in this Sioux Falls community, and so we're grateful for her involvement in worship in that way. She is unable to be present in person for worship this week as her family is under COVID protocol quarantine. So we're praying for them as well, but we're grateful for the sermon that is included in this worship. A couple of other announcements for church. One is next weekend, October 17th, directly following worship, which will take place in the upstairs social hall, we will have a congregational site study and meeting. So there's two things involved in that. One is the site study, which is with Pastor Renee Splicka-Larson, the associate to the bishop for the South Dakota Synod. Will walk us through, the congregation through, looking at the ministry site profile paperwork, which is the paperwork that will then be given to pastoral candidates for the call process. So this is your chance as a congregation to review that draft, to add your input, voice some questions or comments, and to continue in that process for the call committee's work. Also that day, there will be one voting item on the agenda, and that is to re-amateurize the congregation's mortgage. This is to make the payments, the monthly payments, smaller. It would also extend the life and timeline of the mortgage itself. So that needs a congregational vote. Linda Sandlin and Anna Amundsen will lead you through that on that day as well. I will mention too, if you notice in the back here, there is some orange cloth draped over the side of the wall in the front of the sanctuary. That is a sign of solidarity with our Native American siblings, especially Wayotan Ministry and the Pine Ridge Reconciliation Center, two ministries of the South Dakota Synod on the west side of the state. As you may know, tomorrow or Monday will be Indigenous People Native American Day, and we are recognizing that and also standing in solidarity with them, especially in the era that we learn about the boarding school era, the remains of children found from that era and also those who survived. So that is a sign of solidarity on this particular week. Other than that, let's begin in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. I'll lead you through a thanksgiving for baptism. Joined to Christ in the waters of baptism, we are clothed with God's mercy, forgiveness, and grace. Gracious God, you are the river of life. You are the everlasting wellspring. You are the fire of rebirth. Glory to you for oceans and lakes, for rivers and streams. By water and your word, you claim us as your children. Receiving the gifts of your promise and servants of all, you can say, we give you thanks, O God. We give you thanks, O God. Breathe your spirit into all who are gathered, whether it's here in this sanctuary or wherever they may be, and into all creation. Illumine our days, enliven our bones, dry our tears, wash away the brokenness within us, and drown the evil around us. Shower us with your spirit, and renew our lives with your forgiveness, grace, and love. Satisfy our thirst with your living water, Jesus Christ, our Savior, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
God, he reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, increase in us your gift of faith, that being prepared for what lies ahead and recognizing what is behind, we may be given your guidance and receive your gifts of everlasting joy and peace. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Hello, friends of Augustana Lutheran Church. I'm Pastor Catherine Olson, a supply pastor in Sioux Falls. It was my pleasure to be with you last March when Pastor Amy had just left her post at your church and you all were waiting for Pastor John's arrival. And now I'm back, though I'm afraid I might not be with you this Sunday. COVID has struck my household. I record this sermon today for your virtual worship setting, and it's likely that a lay leader will be reading my sermon in Sunday service together with the gathered congregation. I'm so sorry that my time with your congregation this weekend likely won't go as planned, but this is the time we live in. Please pray for me as we muddle through our time with this illness, my family does, and I will keep all of you in my prayers too. I truly hope that each of you are staying healthy and sticking together as a community through many creative means and measures. With that said, let us get into the gospel reading for today, the gospel that comes to us from Mark chapter 10. As Jesus was setting out on a journey, a man ran up and knelt before him and asked him, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" Jesus said to him, "Why do you call me good? No one is good but God alone. You know the commandments. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness. You shall not defraud. Honor your father and your mother." The man said to him, "Teacher, I have kept all these since my youth." Jesus, looking at him, loved him and said, "You lack one thing. Go, sell what you own and give the money to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come follow me." When he heard this, he was shocked and went away grieving, for he had many possessions. Then Jesus looked around and said to his disciples, "How hard will it be for those who have wealth to enter the kingdom of God?" And the disciples were perplexed at these words. But Jesus said to them again, "Children, how hard it is to enter the kingdom of God. It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of God." They were greatly astounded and said to each other, "Then who can be saved?" Jesus looked at them and said, "For mortals, it is impossible, but not for God. For God, all things are possible." Peter began to say to Jesus, "Look, we have left everything and followed you." Jesus said, "Truly, I tell you, there is no one who has left house or brothers or sisters or mother or father or children or fields for my sake and for the sake of the good news, who will not receive a hundredfold now in this age, houses, brothers and sisters, mothers and children, and fields with persecutions, and in the age to come eternal life. But many who are first will be last, and the last will be first." Here ends the gospel lesson. And now for the sermon. A few years ago, I was leading a Bible study on the book of 1 Corinthians, and we came across a rather notorious, harsh passage where Paul writes, "Fornicators, adulterers, male prostitutes, sodomites, thieves, drunkards, robbers, none of these will inherit the kingdom of God." An elderly lady named Betty spoke up and said, "Ouch, I'm glad that's not my problem." "What's not your problem?" I inquired. "Sexual immorality," Betty replied confidently. "That's just one thing that's never been an issue for me. I met my husband Joe when we were young, and we stayed pure while we dated. I wore a white dress to my wedding, back when wearing a white dress actually meant something, not like brides today," Betty declared. "Joe and I were married for 47 years. I was faithful every day of our marriage. So yes, all this business about fornication and adultery, that's just never been a problem of mine." "Betty," I said sweetly, "Jesus said in his Sermon on the Mount that anyone who looks at a woman with lust in his heart has already committed adultery with her in his heart. You mean to tell me that you've never had an interesting thought about, say, Robert Redford?" I knew Betty liked Robert Redford because when she first met my husband, she sidled up next to him and said, "Has anybody ever told you that you look like a young Robert Redford?" Betty thought about Robert Redford for a moment, blushed, and said, "Well," I like to think that that "well" was a confession of sin from dear old Betty. That's the sneaky thing about the commandments in Scripture, the ones that the eager man in our gospel passage claims to have kept since his youth. "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" The man fell before Jesus in his quest to be noticed, to be seen as good and righteous. Jesus said, "Well, you know the commandments," and he named a few of the most famous 10, stating, "You shall not murder, you shall not commit adultery, steal, bear false witness," etc. The eager man looked at Jesus with the sincerity of my friend Betty at Bible study. "Teacher, I have kept all these things since my youth," he responded proudly. "In other words, these commandments of Scripture, Jesus, well, they're just not really a problem for me." The Scripture says that Jesus looked at him in this moment and loved him. Loved him. That is such an unusual detail of the gospel writer, for the gospel writer to note. But that detail of Jesus loving the man, it's an important piece of background that informs Jesus' reply. In the next breath, Jesus will not reassure this eager young salvation seeker. Rather, he will look this man in the eyes, and with love in his heart, Jesus will convict him of his sin. That is what a good teacher does. Either face to face with an individual student or before a whole group of hearers. When a teacher senses that a student is straying from the truth, a good teacher calls the student into a place of truth, even if it hurts. The man before Jesus was in danger of thinking that he had it all figured out, that he could achieve salvation by his own effort, apart from the work of God, by following the so-called commandments. To cut through all that noise, Jesus went right for this man's particular weakness. Jesus goes for this man's idol, his soft spot, his Robert Redford, if you will. "You lack one thing," Jesus declared. "Go, sell what you own and give the money to the poor. You will have treasure in heaven. Then come follow me." "Well," confessed the young man. He was shocked by his teacher's response and went away grieving, for Jesus had indeed revealed his sin to him. This man, who was seemingly a respectable pillar in the community, could not finally be found righteous before Jesus, who stretched the commandments of Scripture to the point where the man could no longer oblige. Apparently, at the heart of the commandments lies a righteousness that no one can touch, including this man. He could not, on the basis of his own merit, enter eternal life. After the man walked away, dejected, Jesus spoke to his disciples and uttered one of his most memorable sayings. Children, how hard it is to enter the kingdom of God. It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than it is for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of God. That phrase really sticks with us, doesn't it? We get so caught up thinking about the needle and the camel and what it means to be truly rich that we blow right past the more universal statement that Jesus utters just beforehand. Children, how hard it is to enter the kingdom of God. The fact that this particular man happened to be rich is almost beside the point. He must have indeed been caught up in his earthly security and status, as we all are. But even more damning was his mistaken belief that there was something that he could do to enter eternal life. Jesus shone a light on this young man's personal weakness, thus revealing his deeply held false belief. Even the disciples were perplexed after this exchange. Then who can be saved? They asked. Jesus looked at them and said, for mortals it is impossible, but not for God. For God all things are possible. So how might this gospel reading speak to our lives today? I think we need to steer the conversation around this passage away from being rich. Now, certainly there is plenty to say in Scripture about the trappings of wealth, but I don't think that's the key lesson in this particular passage, or at least the universal one. We live in a day and age where notorious billionaires are shooting rockets into space, racing against each other for monopolies, power, more and more gain. It's easy for us to fix our eyes on someone like that. And I'm afraid if we get too caught up in the whole what it means to be truly rich aspect of this passage, we might get distracted thinking that the conviction of sin leveled in this passage is meant for somebody else, someone who's not us. Jesus, who loves us, is convicting us of our sin. Sorry about the dog. Jesus, who loves us, is convicting us of our sin through this gospel passage today. For you, your sin might be revealed more clearly in one commandment, and for me, my sin might be more revealed clearly in another. Jesus was notorious for turning up the heat on a number of the commandments, after all. Think you haven't committed murder? I say to you, Jesus said in his Sermon on the Mount, that anyone who is angry with a brother or sister will be subject to judgment. Anyone who says, you fool, like I might want to say to my dog right now, you fool. Anyone who says that might be in danger of the fire of hell. Yikes. Betty, is it getting hot in here or is it just me? Jesus, who loves us, looks at us today and convicts us of our sin, especially the sin of self-righteousness. But we are not those who need to walk away today dejected. We have an additional incredible word from our Lord. Although there is nothing that we could do to inherit the kingdom of God for ourselves, with God, this is possible. With God, all things are possible. In Jesus Christ, we have so much more than a good teacher. We have a Savior. Guess what? It's okay to call yourself a sinner when you know you have a Savior whose job it is to forgive sins. If you are a sinner, congratulations. Welcome to the club. It is you that Jesus sees and loves. Man, it's like I got 14 minutes into this video and this is when the dog starts. I got two more paragraphs, so let's keep this going. The sins in our life that separate us from God, from our neighbors, those toxic patterns that hurt even ourselves, We will struggle with the forces of sin in this life, but they will not be the end of us. Through his life, death, and resurrection, Jesus Christ has destroyed the power of sin and death and has given us the gift of everlasting life. And so today, for our part, we can go back into the world, joyful, relieved even. We don't have to be dejected. We don't have to be deluded into claiming we are perfect when we're not. We are free to be, free to live, free to make mistakes and try again, knowing that in God we have truth and grace. That's something better than Robert Redford. It's the salvation of God through Jesus Christ. Amen.
Gathered together as God's people in Christ Jesus, let us pray for the church, the world, and all of God's creation. Good teacher, your word is living and active in the church. By your spirit, help us to give you everything we have. Give us the will to leave behind those things that hold us back from following you and from serving others. Guide the members of this congregation, especially in this interim time and in this call process, as well as our partner congregation, Pueblo de Dios, and their leader, Pastor Maria. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Merciful God, help us love your gift of creation and be good caretakers of all that you provide. Heal the earth where it is broken, and give us hands and hearts to work for healing. Give the world honest leaders who speak truth, uphold the rights of the poor and in need, and work for the good of all. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Gracious God, with boldness, we pray for those who suffer in any way, whether it is adversity, addiction, alienation, or illness. Pray especially for Cindy this week. Give them mercy and help in time of need. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We rejoice with the saints who lived steadfastly in your love and now rest fully in your peace, including this week for Pastor Dan Ofstehag, pastor at Lutheran Church of Our Redeemer in Watertown. We commend Dan to your care, and we look to the day when we too will praise you face to face. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Into your hands, gracious Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Now let us pray together our Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And now, as you go on your way, receive the blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine on you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in peace. Serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.